Okay, we're gonna get going with the program this evening, and I know people have gotten their meals at different times, so continue eating, including your dessert. And even if you're diabetic like me, tonight you can have dessert. The Lord spoke to me and said that that was okay. But every year, we recognize some of our members who have gone to be with the Lord during this year. And Robbie Dean's going to come up and talk about Hal Hagemeyer.
Now, a lot of you probably didn't know Hal Hagemeyer because Hal was a real quiet guy. I first met Hal in the first grade in Sunday school at Baraka Church in Houston, Texas. That was a couple of years ago. And so we knew each other, and his younger brother was also was my age, and I knew him a little better, but Chuck went to be with the Lord a few years ago, so now Hal has joined his wife and his brother with the Lord. He went to be with the Lord on the 29th of August. And Hal was a real servant. He served his country for almost 30 years, achieving the rank of full colonel in the Air Force. And he went after retirement and even during his last years on active duty, he was very active in the National Capital Bible Church, where Dan Ingram is pastor. He led the singing, he was a deacon, and he was also on the board of Chafer Theological Seminary. And Hal was very faithful in coming to pre-trib for the last 15 years, and just a real testimony in the way he served the Lord during his life.
Thank you. And Gary Grimacki is going to come up and talk about his father.
So great to be here at this conference, and I remember several times that my dad and I came to this conference together, and father-son legacy there, and passing it on hopefully to the next generation. 2 Timothy 4, 7 and 8 says, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. As I look back on my life and think about the impact that my dad has had on me, Dr. Robert Grimacki, I think about the fact that my dad was a wonderful father to me, a spiritual leader in our family, who read the Word of God to us and prayed for us daily. Dad and Mom left a wonderful example to us as husband and wife, married for 68 years. And God blessed Dad and Mom with two children, six grandchildren, and five great-grandchildren. As you know, Dad faithfully taught Bible and Greek at Cedarville University for 50 years, 1960 to 2010. And it was a joy for me to take all of my dad's classes at Cedarville. One of my favorite classes was the Book of Revelation, and now I have the opportunity to teach the Book of Revelation at Calvary University in Kansas City. In October, I was privileged to go with my mom to my dad's grave, and it was a beautiful day, and I got my Bible out, and I read 1 Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18, and after prayer, I looked up, and I said, Mom, someday soon, Dad's going to come back. His soul's going to join to his body, and he's going to have a resurrection right here. And then we're all going to be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. Maranatha, even so come, Lord Jesus.
This year we're going to present the Walvoord Award, and that is an award that we give to one of our members who we don't have membership anymore, but people that come to our conference, and for outstanding work in the field of prophecy. And John Walvoord was the dean of Bible prophecy, you know, pre-trib and all of that kind of stuff, and that's why he used to come here every year when he was alive. Obviously, I don't guess he comes anymore, but... And this year, we're going to give it to Dr. David Reagan. Dave grew up in Waco, Texas. It's a real Baptist town, isn't it? And he graduated from the University of Texas, and he earned his graduate degrees from Harvard in international relations. And he was the assistant to the president of Austin College in Sherman. I went to first grade in Sherman. And president of South Texas Junior College in Houston, and director of Pepperdine University Center for International Business in Los Angeles, and vice president of Phillips University in Enid, Oklahoma. In the mid-60s, Dave served as a Fulbright lecturer at the University of the Philippines and toured all the Southeast Asia lecturing on U.S. foreign policy on behalf of the U.S. Information Agency. Dave is a lifelong Bible student, teacher, and preacher. He entered the full-time ministry in 1978 when he was called to serve as the pulpit minister for a church in Irving. Hey, we're in Irving. Yeah, okay, Texas. In April 1980, Dave founded Lamb and Lion Ministries, which produced radio programs for the first 20 years. And I remember I had just finished my coursework at Dallas, and I was working for Wing Tip Couriers for a couple of months. And I started listening when your program just started. And I kept wondering, is he pre-trib? Is he pre-trib? And I think it was the third program I listened to where he taught the preacher of rapture, and I went, praise hallelujah, or something like that. And so for 20 years they did radio, and the last almost 20 years now they've done TV. I'm sure many of y'all have watched his TV program called Christ and Prophecy. And he's authored many religious essays, which have been published in a wide variety of journals and magazines, in other words, articles. And he was written 17 books and has contributed to many others. His books have been translated into several languages, and Dave has a tremendous impact in teaching and defending the preacher of rapture. And so tonight's my great privilege to present the John Walvoord Award to Dr. Reagan, if you would come on up.
Thank you very much. I'm going to speak Wednesday morning and tell about my pilgrimage to a premillennial viewpoint, because I grew up in a militantly amillennial church, so militant that we were taught it was a sin to say the Lord's Prayer because it talks about thy kingdom come, and they said the kingdom's already come, so you shouldn't pray that prayer. So I'm going to talk about it's a miracle of God that I ended up teaching Bible prophecy. Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Well, you never know what life may hold, right? So, Andy Woods is going to come up here. And Andy, make sure you stand up so people can see you.
All right. Thank you. Um, Dr. Tim LaHaye's, who was our co-founder, along with Thomas Seiss, had a vision for this organization, which is to really debate, defend academically, and promote our dispensational, pre-tribulational, premillennial perspective. And I don't know of any other organization that does that, you know, at this level. So with the passing of Tim LaHaye, the pre-trib Research Center is a totally separate organization, and it survives based on conference registration fees and personal donations. So with that being said, we would just like people this evening to prayerfully consider donating to the pre-trib study group. On your table are envelopes with new addresses of the Pre-Trib Research Center. So if you would take that envelope and prayerfully consider making a contribution to the center, it would be greatly appreciated. Now, that's what they wanted me to read. Now I'm going to say something. Can I do that? The only thing I want to say is if we as God's people don't get behind an organization like this, who's going to do it? Amen. So with that being said, thank you.
Right now, we're going to have Sean Crane, who is a worship pastor at Center Fark Baptist Church in Hot Springs, Arkansas. And he's a real hot singer. So come on up here and let her rip, Tater Chip.
It would be interesting to sing the wrong words to the wrong song. I've got hope when things look bad, and I can smile when I should be sad. I've got friends who lift me up when I'm feeling low, and they watch over me wherever I may go. I've got friends in the high places, so high but not so far away. I've got friends in the high places, and I'm gonna be with them someday. There's the Father, right by His Son, and the angels, each and every one, and other friends I miss so much, and I long to see, but knowing I'll be with them one day, comforts me. I've got friends in high places, so high but not so far away. I've got friends in high places, and I'm gonna be with them someday. Why should I run? Why should I hide? What's there to fear when my friends are on my side? I've got friends in high places, so high but not so far away. I've got friends in a high places, and I'm gonna be with them. I'm gonna be with them. So high, but not so far away. I've got friends in high places, and I'm gonna be with them. Yes, I'm gonna be with them someday. I can't wait. Someday, I'm going to be with them. Marketplace is empty, no more traffic in the streets. All the builders' tools are silent, no more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labors, in the courtrooms no debate. Work on earth has been suspended as the King comes through the gate. The King is coming. The King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. The King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, he is coming for me. Faces line the hallways, those whose lives have been redeemed, and broken homes that he has mended, those from prison he set free, little children and the aged, hand in hand stand all the glory. Those who were crippled, broken, ruined, clad in garments white as snow. The King is coming. The King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. The King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, he is coming for me. Chariots rumble, I can see the marching throng, and the flurry of God's trumpets spells the end of sin and wrong. Regal robes are now unlocked.
Thank you so much for that. Well, our speaker this evening is Jeff Kinley, and he's from Little Rock, Arkansas. And that's the state just directly east from my home state of Oklahoma. Now, if you've been to Oklahoma, you know folks from Oklahoma are pretty cultured and sophisticated. But, you know, Arkansas, you know, not so much. In fact, you know, they say that in Arkansas, the idea of hors d'oeuvres is potted meat on a saltine. And even, you know, even if it goes all the way to their football team, it says, you know, why do the Arkansas Razorbacks eat cereal straight from the box? They choke when they get near a bowl. Yeah. I don't know if they're in a bowl. I don't think they even got the one. How do you know you're from Arkansas? Your mom has been in a fist fight at a sporting event. One final insight into Arkansas culture is a guy named Bubba from Arkansas, and he had a friend over in the evening, and his friend had a heart attack, so he called 911. And they said, well, where do you live? And he said, they're going to send the ambulance. It's at 123 Eucalyptus Drive. And the dispatcher paused for a moment and said, asked him, how do you spell, will you spell eucalyptus for me? And Bubba paused for just a minute, and he says, well, how about if I drag him over to Oak Street and you just pick him up over there? Anyway, we could go on and on with these. I won't do that. But Jeff is proof that something good can come from Arkansas. So but we met years ago through a common friend, a friend of ours named Bill Jensen. And Jeff is a graduate of Dallas Seminary. He's the author of 40 books. 12 of his books are on Bible prophecy. I know many of you have read those, have them in your library. We've co-authored two books together, and I can just say about Jeff, he's just a joy, a complete joy to work with in that. He's got two podcasts, Prophecy Pros and Vintage Truth. He's become really a go-to trusted voice really in our nation, a lot of national programs on end-time prophecy. He's been married to his wife, Bev, for 41 years, and my wife loves Bev, and they've become good friends. He's got three sons, five grandchildren. Really, the greatest thing I can say about Jeff, he's a faithful ambassador of our Lord Jesus Christ. He really is in every forum where he appears, and he's my friend, and he's been a great blessing, a great encouragement in my life. You know, there's an old saying that a friend is someone who multiplies your joys and divides your sorrows. And he's certainly been that to me and to my family. So, Jeff, may the Lord richly bless you, brothers, you come and minister God's word to us. And don't hold that stuff I said about Arkansas against me.
Well, I appreciate that. Most of it is true. But, you know, that's just the way it is, isn't it? Well, I'm excited to be with you here this evening. It's a privilege to be here. I want to say thank you to Tommy Ice for inviting me to come and giving me the opportunity to share God's word with you. It's been an interesting journey for me the past 9 days. I have kind of been all around the world a little bit the past few days. I started out in my hometown, obviously, of Little Rock, and then I went to, flew on an hour and a half flight to Atlanta, then a 2-hour flight to Detroit. After that was a 14-hour flight to Japan, where I spent 24 hours in the Japan airport there in Tokyo. If you've never been there, just so you'll know, you're probably not going to eat the food. It's just not something you want to do while you're there. But I was there for 24 hours, then another 7-hour flight to Singapore, landed at midnight, got up at dawn the next morning to preach at a local church. And then after that, I took a 4-hour van ride to Malaysia for a Bible conference. After 5 days of teaching there and a Q&A that just went on and on and on and on, We got into a 6-hour van ride back to Singapore, and about halfway through the ride back, they made a phone call to the van where I was in and said, Mr. Kinley left something back in his hotel room. I thought, well, surely I didn't leave anything. And they said, well, it's just a pouch full of credit cards and cash. I said, oh, yeah, that. I remember that now. And so a miraculous story about how that was recovered. So after that was another 6.5 hour flight back to Seoul, 12 hours in the airport, another 13.5 hour flight from Seoul to Atlanta, 4.5 hour layover in Atlanta, where I at least got to watch the SEC championship, Roll Tide, and then finally back home, and then on the plane to Dallas this morning. So suffice it to say that my body not only doesn't know where I am, it doesn't know when I am. And so I'm in a kind of a conundrum here tonight, but thank you, Mark, for those kind introductory words. I'm going to make you feel guilty now. So, because when I go to the gym and I get on the treadmill, put my headphones in, I'm typically watching a Mark Hitchcock sermon because I want to see how to do it right. And I guess what I'm trying to say is your sermons make me break out into a sweat. That's all I'm trying to say here tonight. So, even though I don't know where I am, I think we can confidently say tonight that we know where we are, that we are late in the game. The Bible says in 1 John 2:18, little children, it is the last hour. And if it was the last hour in the first century, we must be in the last moments, the last seconds of human history. We are waiting eagerly and with great anticipation for our Lord Jesus Christ. But like many today, there's a lot of confusion. There's a lot of white noise out there about what's going on in the world. People are confused about the war in Israel. There's obviously a lot of narratives that are out there about that. But people are wondering what's happening in the world and how close could the return of Christ be. We look back at the original disciples and we see that they were also confused about things, confused about Christ's kingdom, about who Jesus was initially, about what he was here to do. And so we're going to look at tonight one of those stories where the disciples had quite a conundrum in Matthew chapter 14. So you're welcome to follow along with me in your Bibles there if you have one. I'm going to talk about tonight about Jesus Christ, a hero for the ages. You know, a hero has been defined as someone who gives of himself, often putting his own life at great risk for the greater good of others. The Cambridge Dictionary defines a hero as a person who is admired for having done something very brave or having achieved something very, very great. A hero is known for courageous acts, for selfless service, for a nobility of character, for coming through in the last minute to save the day. And we certainly, as we look over our lives and over history, can point back to heroes, men and women who met those qualifications. I think of someone like a Kirk Gibson playing for the Los Angeles Dodgers in the ninth inning of the 1991 World Series. A man so banged up, his knees were so inoperative, they didn't even introduce him as being a member of the team that night. But when the call came, Gibson answered and hit a hot line drive over the right field wall and won the first game of the 1991 World Series. I think about others who've won NCAA basketball championships. I remember growing up, one of my heroes was Dr. J. Now, Dr. J was Michael Jordan before there was Michael Jordan, just so you'll know that. And I'm one of these guys, and I don't know how this happened to me, but I have almost supernatural facial recognition skills. So you can be sure if I've ever seen your face, I will never forget your face. I promise you I will forget your name. But I will never forget your face. And so I'm speaking in Charleston, South Carolina. This is many years ago, and I'm walking down this little corridor here outdoors, and I look up, and coming right towards me is Julius Erving, Dr. J. And I immediately became just, I was like a teenage girl at a Taylor Swift concert. I mean, I didn't know what to do with myself. I got chills all over my body. I started shaking. I looked back at my wife. I said, Dr. J, you know, and she said, well, go meet him. I said, I can't meet him. Of course you can. Go meet him. So I sheepishly walked up to him, and I just, you know, what do you say? I mean, you always say the wrong thing to your heroes. I just said, Mr. Irving, you have no idea the impact you made on my life when I was playing basketball. He was so humble, shook his hand, wrapped around my hand about four times. Man's hands were huge. Got him a picture taken with him, that kind of thing. Just, you know, meeting your heroes is a great thing to do. I think about war heroes, men like Audie Murphy. I think about men like Desmond Doss, who on May 4th, 1945, Doss spent 12 hours single-handedly retrieving and lowering wounded bodies of American soldiers from the battlefield to safety down the edge of a cliff in what's called Hacksaw Ridge. Once a man was lowered to safety, he would whisper a prayer, Lord, help me get one more. Lord, help me get one more. And he did. He was the hero of Hacksaw Ridge. I think about the speech that Winston Churchill gave to the House of Commons right after the Battle of Britain, citing the heroic efforts and sacrifice made by the Royal Air Force in holding off the Luftwaffe in this pivotal battle, Churchill remarked, "Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few." Heroes. We need heroes today. And there are very scant few of them. Scripture also has its heroes. You think of men like Joshua, men like David, Moses, Shadrach, Esther, Elijah, Gideon, and yes, even Samson. But they all pale compared to the Lord Jesus Christ. He is our hero. And one such heroic moment occurs right here in Matthew chapter 14. The context is just after the feeding of the 5,000, which is a miracle that's recorded in all four Gospels. Jesus fed that day, that was 5,000 men, perhaps 15, 20,000 people were there that day, and he fed them all, did miracles for them, healed the sick. And after this, the Bible says in verse 22, it says, "And immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side of Galilee, and he sent the multitudes away." And I want us to look at a couple of things here tonight about this incredible story here. First of all, just to watch what Christ did with the command he gave his disciples. You know, there's something about the word that Christ used there, or that Matthew uses here, that has a sense of compelling, constraining about the disciples. In other words, they didn't want to go. They didn't want to leave Jesus. Jesus said, "No, you go. There's a command. I want you to go somewhere." And Christ went back, and it says, to send the multitudes away. John tells us that earlier in that day, they had wanted to make him king. They had the right conclusion about Jesus, the right conclusion about the prophecies, but they had the wrong timing, the wrong kind of kingdom. You know, I find today that people have the right prophecies, but the wrong timing. You know, people are always asking me, they say, "Jeff, you know, I know we're close, but how close are we?" And I always respond, "Close." Yeah, I know, but I mean, don't you think that it has to happen in the next 3 to 5 years? How close do you think we are? And I said, "We're close." But they always want to nail you down, you know, to one thing. You have the right prophecies, but the wrong kind of timing. And Jesus said, "No, it's not my time." Plus, it would have gotten him arrested, and he wouldn't have been able to complete the mission the Father sent him to do. So the Bible says here that in verse 23, after he had sent the multitudes away, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. And when it was evening, he was there alone. Earlier, we find out that Jesus had just learned of the death of John the Baptist. And the Bible says he went away to grieve. He went away to contemplate that. You know, Christ, being the Son of God, was also 100% man. He felt the things that we feel. He grieved. He hurt. He bled. He was thirsty. He was hungry. And he certainly grieved over the death of John the Baptist. Perhaps he's going to the mountain to grieve more about John's beheading. But meanwhile, the disciples are in the boat headed across the Sea of Galilee, and something happens. They encounter a storm. Verse 24 says, "But the boat was already many stadia away from the land, battered by the waves, for the wind was contrary." Now, John, in his account, tells us that they were about 3 to 4 miles away. So they had gone quite into the Sea of Galilee there. And, of course, storms which are common on that sea there had whipped up in a frenzy. And this little boat that was about 26 feet long, about 7.5 feet wide, was being tossed to and fro by the waves. And the disciples, it says in Mark chapter 6, were straining at the oars. And it was a very, very difficult time for them. In fact, the night was there, and they were beginning to panic. The English novelist Sir Edward George Orwell wrote in his 1830 book, Paul Clifford, he began the book this way: "It was a dark and stormy night, and the rain fell in torrents." And certainly, the disciples were experiencing their own dark and stormy night there. They were definitely not experiencing their best life now. There were no promises to claim. No miracles were happening for them at the moment. But they were in peril. They were in mortal danger, and they were on the verge of capsizing and drowning. Many of them fishermen who had been on this sea many times before. And Jesus? Well, Jesus was nowhere to be found. Where is Jesus in the storm? Maybe you've been there before, finding yourself in the midst of your own storm. Maybe you're a pastor here tonight, and you've experienced your ministry dwindling. Finances are down. People are against you in the church. Maybe personally you've experienced sickness or financial hardship or family struggles, maybe a personal or emotional crisis, maybe that dark moment of the soul, maybe the heights of anxiety or the depths of depression have plagued you in your life. You have people attacking you because you're a believer in Jesus. The world seems to be against you. People are criticizing you. The devil is accusing you, and even your own heart is full of doubt, condemning you, pelting you with the torrential driving rain of self-doubt. Yeah, these dark nights of the soul. I venture to say that if you've lived for Christ for very long, you've had some of these nights where you've wondered, God, where are you in my storm? Where is Jesus in all this? And sometimes we ask ourselves the questions, I'm sure the disciples did. You could have prevented the storm, right? I mean, God certainly could have gone ahead and prevented these bad things. Why do bad things happen to good people? I like to ask the question, why do good things happen to bad people? That's certainly where we belong. He could have prevented the storm, but he didn't. And so the disciples end up in this boat wondering how this whole story will end. Now, to be fair, some of life's storms are self-caused. In fact, I love this meme here that says, everything happens for a reason. Sometimes the reason is you're stupid and make bad decisions. Guilty as charged, Your Honor. Yeah, we make bad decisions in the storm there. But also, some storms that we experience are caused by just the world that we live in. We live in a fallen world, a depraved world, a wicked world. We're in spiritual warfare right now. There's a battle in the heavenlies, a battle behind the scenes. And if you've been a believer for any length of time, you know that battle. You understand that there are forces of wickedness in high places that are working against you, against your ministry, against your organization, against your family. And this fallen world brings storms. Some storms are satanic in origin. You think about Job and how Satan was given permission to be in control of the whirlwind. Some storms are from Satan. And then other storms are from God. We'll read about that in the book of Jonah, how God sent a storm. So certainly there are storms in our lives and things happen to us, and we don't always know why they're happening. But in the storm, we want to see God. We want to know that God is there with us in the storm, that he hasn't abandoned us. Because sometimes in those lonely moments, we kind of think, well, maybe the Lord's just removing his hand of blessing. Or maybe he's not with me in his presence like he used to be. And then we begin to pray, Lord, just come through. Just come through for me one more time. Well, that's where these disciples were. Well, the good news is that Jesus Christ appears to them. In verses 25 and 26, it says, in the fourth watch, somewhere between 3 and 6 a.m., it says, he came to them walking on the sea. Walking on the sea. So Jesus Christ appears. Now, one of the other Gospels tells us in Mark 6, it says Jesus intended to pass them by, which is kind of a strange thought if you think about it. Here are the disciples out there struggling for their lives, and Jesus says, I'm on my way to the other side. Going to pass you by. And yet, we don't know why Jesus had that particular motivation. Perhaps he just wanted them to see him walk by. Maybe a sort of a theophany type appearance. He wanted them to know that the storm was not affecting him and he was over the storm. Keep in mind, he had just fed some 20,000 people. He'd just done incredible miracles. But apparently they weren't thinking about that. And also notice that he waits until they're in their most critical moment. Christ didn't come to them walking on the water when they first left the shore. He came when they were about to go under. He suddenly appears in the storm. I believe that Jesus passed by them to reassure them that he was still there and that he was still God. But the disciples didn't see it that way. They didn't get the lesson. And so what we see next is the fear. Verse 26 says, and when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were frightened, saying, it is a ghost. It is a ghost. And they cried out for fear. It's an apparition. It can't be real. And so they were filled with fear. Instead of saying, oh, it's Jesus. It's Christ. It's our Lord. It's the one we worship. It's the one we love. It's the one we know. They were afraid. They didn't respond even to the provision of his presence near their boat there. And they were filled with fear. The Bible says they cried out for fear. As my former professor used to say at Dallas Seminary, Howard Hendricks used to say, they were scared spitless. And they were. Now, why is Jesus doing this? Well, we don't know exactly why he's doing this, but I think one reason we could say is that he's exhibiting once again his sovereign power over nature. That Christ is letting them know that he's in charge of the storm, that he's above the storm, that he's not sinking down. He's giving them evidence, one more evidence, that he is indeed God Almighty. But like many of us, sometimes we tend to be a little bit hard-hearted or hard-headed, and God has to give us the message over and over and over again. How many times have we gotten the message from God and just said to ourselves, well, I've got it. You don't need to say this again. I've got it. No, typically, we become forgetful, don't we? We forget the blessings of God. We forget the message of God. We forget the presence of God. We forget why that we followed him in the first place. I think another reason is because he just wanted them to trust him. I mean, he already told them, go to the other side. I'll meet you there. He's going to go there. But they think they're going to go under. So I think one reason why Christ is there for them is that he wants them to trust him. The Bible says in Hebrews 11, without faith is impossible to please God. And Jesus simply wants us to trust him. Sometimes that's the hardest thing to do in life, is to just exercise simple faith in the Lord. God says, I'm going to do it. I believe it. You know, we were talking about debating people here earlier tonight, and you know, I get into these Q&As sometimes. People ask you a question, and you tell them what the Bible says. And their response is, yeah, but. Wait a minute, I just gave you the highest authority in the universe. I have nothing else to give you there but God's Word. And yet they want to have some sort of caveat to that. So what happens next? Well, we have the assurance here in verse 27. It says, but immediately Jesus spoke to them saying, take courage. It is I, do not be afraid. So he identifies himself in case they're still thinking that it's an actual ghost. Jesus says, no, it's me. And they recognize the voice. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice and they follow me. His words were meant to reassure them. His presence was meant to comfort them. And Christ's desire, I believe, in that situation, like in many of the dark moments and storms of our life, is not to explain all of the what, all of the why, but simply to say the who is here. Simply to say, God is here. There's so many unanswerable questions about life and about the Christian life. And sometimes we just need to know God is near, and that's it. That's really all we need. His presence, I think, demonstrated his willingness to do whatever it took to reassure and eventually rescue his children. He wanted them to know and to recognize that God was in the storm with them. You would think one of the disciples would elbow another one and say, hey, it says in Psalm 139, he's with us even the remote part of the sea. So we can take comfort of that. The Bible says in Psalm 23, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, that's where we are right now, guys. Take courage. I'll fear no evil, for thou art with me. But no scripture apparently is being shared on that boat. How often the truth about God is the first casualty in our circumstance. That we bypass the clear truth about what God says about himself, about what he says about us, about our relationship with him, and we run immediately to our emotions or to our circumstances, to our own thoughts, instead of remembering God's eternal word and allow it to dictate our thoughts and dominate our hearts. We tend to trust in ourselves, and that is the struggle, is it not? To go from trusting in self to trusting in God. And just to be content with the fact that he is here, and that's all I really need. When I was 13 years old, I got a job one summer. I wanted to buy a 10-speed bicycle. So my dad said, well, you're going to have to get a job. So I said, okay, I'll get a job. Where can I get a job? So he got me a job working at a graveyard. And my job was to edge around the tombstones. And I got paid $1.60 an hour, and I worked all summer long in that job and saved up money for a 10-speed bicycle. I've never been so happy as a young boy in my whole life. I got that bicycle. I rode it everywhere in my life. And I remember I was over at my cousin's house, We were riding around this big driveway, and there was this girl there that really caught my eye. And I don't remember her name, but you know I remember her face, right? Okay. So I see this girl, and I'm like, well, it's time to show off. And so I start riding, you know, hands free, you know, doing one of these things, you know. I'm looking over at her, seeing if she's watching me, because that's really the point, right? And as soon as I do that, I pass by a pole, supported pole for the garage, and my hand hits the pole and bends my hand back and snaps this bone in half right here. And, of course, the first thing I thought of was, what just happened? I look down at my wrist. It's starting to swell up. And my cousin's mom put some ice on it. I'm sweating profusely. I'm starting to get nauseous. I don't know what's going to happen next. I've never broken a bone in my whole life. So she calls my brother, who is at home, my older brother, and he came over to get me, and he takes me to the emergency room. I get in the emergency room, and I walk in there, and you know how doctors can be very, very compassionate. And so we had this doctor come in. He took a look at my hand. He lifted it up and dropped it down on the table again. He said, yeah, it's broken. So well, it wasn't before. It sure is now. And I said to my brother, Danny, I said, Danny, where's Dad? He said, Dad's coming. Don't worry. I sat there another hour in that little emergency room cubicle. I said, Danny, where's Dad? He said, don't worry, Dad's coming. Pretty soon the doctor and a nurse came in. They were holding the largest needle I'd ever seen in my life. I swear today, it must have been this long. And I'm sitting there going, are you going to put that in me? And he said, yeah, we're going to put it inside your wrist about five times. We're going to deaden it up before I pull that bone and set it right. I'm like, I don't think I like that plan. So here comes the doctor, the nurse, and they're about ready to hold me down. I'm trembling. I'm shaking. I'm sweating. My wrist is swollen. I'm about to throw up there in the emergency room. I'm thinking to myself, if I throw up, it's going to be on that doctor. I don't like that man. And right before they plunged the needle into my wrist, the curtain parted, and there was my dad. When my eyes met him, my heart rate instantly lowered. My sweating stopped. My trembling ceased because my father was there. My dad came over and put his hand on my shoulder, and I just remember thinking, my world is right again. Do whatever you need to do because my dad was there. That's what the disciples needed to conclude in that moment. Jesus is here. We're going to be okay. It's fine. Let's believe in him. I love what John MacArthur writes. He says, the storm is never so severe, the night never so black, our boat never so frail that we are ever out of our Savior's care. He's always there. Corrie ten Boom, contemplating her time in Ravensbrück concentration camp, famously said, there is no pit so deep that God's love is not deeper still. And sometimes we find ourselves in those pits. Well, while the disciples are still attempting to keep the boat and their faith from capsizing, one of them speaks up. You know who it is, right? It's Peter. And so that's where we see the challenge here. Verses 28 and 29, Peter answered and said to him, Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water. And he said, come. And Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water towards Jesus. What must that have been like? To get up as a mere mortal and to, if you will, get your feet wet and to begin walking towards Jesus Christ, and all of a sudden he finds himself defying gravity and the laws of nature itself. What an experience that must have been. What was going through his mind? But as you know, it didn't last very long. It says in verse 30, but seeing the wind, he became afraid and beginning to sink, he cried out, Lord, save me. That was the failure that Peter experienced there. You know, I find that people in ministry, and I was a pastor for some 35 years, that the people that come on the strongest in the beginning are the ones that don't last. The ones that are so eager, so enthusiastic, they're so ready, they've got their Bible, it's open, they're ready to take notes. Those are the first ones to be taken out in the spiritual battle. Like the sower and the soils, Satan comes down and snatches that seed up. full of promise, but like many other things in life, being a believer requires consistency over intensity. God wants consistency in our lives. And Peter begins to plummet downward. And there he goes. Peter, you failed again. Again. You're always the one to want to be the first in everything, but you end up failing most times. We give Peter a hard time, don't we? Peter's the eager beaver. He's the impulsive one, the blurter. He's the one that's the overconfident disciple. He's the one, if you'll recall, who wanted to go to war in the Garden of Gethsemane. Peter was ready. His motto was, bring it. Bring it. I'll be here. I'll be ready. I've got this dagger. He's also the one who denied Christ three times. But you know, I have to ask myself, at least he was there. I mean, where were the other disciples during that time? They were cowering somewhere else, not in a boat, but in a house somewhere. He was willing to be in the fight. He was willing to get into the game. He wanted his life to count for Christ. He was willing to do whatever it took. So while the rest of his buddies were cowering in fear, Peter was out in the storm defying gravity, at least for a bit. Peter wanted to be with Jesus. I love what Teddy Roosevelt wrote in his famous speech in Paris on April 23rd, 1910. It was originally titled A Citizen in a Republic, but this famous speech began to be known as The Man in the Arena. Teddy Roosevelt said, "It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short again and again, because there's no effort without error and shortcoming, but who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat." See, Peter failed often because he tried often, because he was a man who persevered. It's a great character trait. Love what William Carey said. He said, "Expect great things from God, attempt great things for God." Some of you in this room are attempting great things for God. Years ago, we moved to an area in our city that was sort of a midtown area. It's a very historic neighborhood in Little Rock, and we bought this big old house that needed work. So the next 16 years, that's what I did mainly on the weekends. Some of you can identify with that. And yet we decided, you know, God, we want to have an impact, a presence here for Christ in this neighborhood. There were satanic shops in our neighborhood. There was a lesbian and gay church in our neighborhood. So we wanted to bring something out. So I said, well, let's just start something. So we started this little church. Had no idea who would show up. And in walks every musician and tattooed, pierced up, unchurched person. They just began coming. And I didn't know what to do with them. I just said, all right, here's what we're going to do. We're going to preach the Bible, and we're going to love you. And that's it. That's all we're going to do. And we saw Buddhists, atheists, agnostics. We saw strippers. We saw doubters. We saw haters of God. We saw them all come to Christ. And, of course, typically in Arkansas, Mark, we didn't have a baptistry, so we just filled up the back of a pickup truck. Hey, look, water. What prevents you from being baptized, right? That's how we roll back then. But before we started this work that lasted for some 10 years and reached these people, I went to a trusted mentor of mine, a man by the name of Dr. Carl Winger. And Dr. Winger was an elder in our church. He was a surgeon in the area, but he was much, much more than that. Dr. Winger brought the concept of a Bible church to Little Rock, Arkansas. No one had ever heard of a Bible church. No one had ever heard of Dallas Seminary before. And we thought, people thought they were a cult, actually. And so Dr. Winger started a Bible church right there in Little Rock, Arkansas. He brought Bible study fellowship to Arkansas. He brought Young Life to Arkansas. And years after years after years, he and his faithful wife, Lib, just served the community. He just kept on doing innovative, great things for God till the very end. So I went to Dr. Winger. I said, Dr. Winger, I'm thinking about starting this crazy little church thing here. I said, you want to give me any advice? So he began to talk, began to tell me things, and I began to listen. His wife at the time, Lib, was in the final stages of Alzheimer's. She could hardly speak. In fact, she stayed silent for weeks upon end. But she was there at the table that day sitting. And right before, I said, Dr. Winger, would you pray for my wife and myself? Lib spoke up. She hadn't spoken in weeks. I'll never forget what she said. She just said as clear as day, she said, I wish I had asked for more. I wish I'd asked God for more. Isn't that where you want to be in your life? In your final moments? You want to be able to say, I wish I'd asked God for more. I want to ask Him for big things. Why? He's a big God. That's why. I want to attempt great things for God and expect great things from God. Peter was just like that. He wasn't content to be on the sidelines. He wanted to be in the game. Put me in coach. He said, I'm ready to play. So he was willing to fail, willing to fall, but he was not willing to remain where he was. Jesus was out there. So Peter wanted to be out there with Jesus. If you've ever attempted something great for God, you know exactly what Peter's feeling at that moment. Because the wind and the wave are all around. You're about to go under at any time. I know there are people in this room who can have this testimony. You walked away from a lucrative business career to pursue full-time ministry. You left that all behind. And many times you thought to yourself, am I crazy? What was I thinking? You started that nonprofit because you had a burning message you knew the world needed to hear. You refinanced your home so that you could fund the ministry that you were starting. You were at a church with a stable income, but you left that church to start your own ministry. You calculated the potential years you have left and decided it's now or never to do what God's called me to do. And you launched out from the boat. You felt the restlessness and discontentment that accompanies spiritual mediocrity, and you're sick of it. Because now is the time for believers to be on fire for Jesus Christ. There's no time for mediocrity. You longed for an adventure from God, and nothing could stop you from pursuing it. Some of you left your longtime church because your church left the Word of God, and you had to move on. Some of you live like near paupers while in seminary, because you believe Jesus was telling you to come follow me. Financial hardship, missed mortgage payments. Maybe you've gone hungry a few times. Maybe you had your car repossessed because God gave you a vision and you were sticking to that vision. Maybe some folks here tonight have even failed at ministry. You say, you know, I tried, I failed. Well, Peter could say, if he could walk through that door tonight, he'd put his hand on your shoulder and say, I know exactly how you feel. Exactly how. If that describes you, then you are the man, you are the woman in the arena. You're a boat-hopping, wave-walking disciple. So Peter's faith was enough to get him out of the boat, but it wasn't enough to get him across the water to Jesus. And he cries out, Lord, save me. And the Bible says that immediately Jesus, in verse 31, immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and took hold of him and said to him, O, you of little faith, why did you doubt? You know, the three times in verse 22, 27, and 31 mentions the word immediately, and they all relate to what Jesus did. Jesus always responds to us when his children cry, O, you of little faith, why did you doubt? So I ask, where is your faith taking you tonight? As you sit here at this banquet, where are you going? Where are you headed? What's your direction? Where is Jesus leading you? Where do you see Christ and you want to be a part of that? What God-sized tasks are you ambitious to attempt? And are you willing to put your faith, all of it, on the line? Are you willing to wager it all on Jesus Christ tonight? Well, Christ gets in the boat. The Bible tells us that the wind stopped. And those who were in the boat, it says, worshiped him, saying, you certainly are God's son. The question is, why weren't you worshiping him while you were in the boat? Why didn't you worship him during the storm? Why did you have to see that miracle? Why was not Christ enough? Mark 6:52 says, "For they had not gained any insight from the incident of the loaves, but their heart was hardened." Their heart was hardened. You see, when we see God do things in our lives, it's supposed to refresh our faith and build our faith. And like a muscle, it's supposed to exercise our faith. And when we don't respond to what God's done in our lives in the past, our hearts become hardened. So the next time he does something, it's kind of like, yeah, whatever. The disciples had that experience. John tells us in his account that as soon as Jesus got in the boat, suddenly the boat was there on the shore at their destination, whether by supernatural means or not. Right now, we're in the midst of a gathering storm of ourselves, a storm in this world of apocalyptic proportions. Tectonic, moral, and geopolitical shifts are all around us, and God is flashing neon signs to the planet and to humanity that he's about to do something. And the check engine light, if you will, is flashing on. Because of this, there's no time for believers to stay in the boat. It's time for us to be more like Peter, to say, I've got to get out of this boat and do something for Christ while I can in this world. And who is this Christ that's waiting for us? He's a God of great detail, a God of precision, a God who is sovereign, a God who still seeks sinners even in this midnight hour. He's a God of wrath, of grace, and of glory in earth's final days. He's a God of vengeance. He's a God of anger. He's a God of prophecy, a promise-keeping God. He's a God who is jealous for his bride. He is a God who will not share his glory with another. He's a God who walks on the very water he himself made, suspending his own laws of physics and nature. He is the Jesus who has pre-scripted history, that every single prophetic word will come to pass exactly as prophesied. He's a God who has sounded the death knell for Satan, the ruler of this world. He indeed is our hero. He's the hero who was born of a virgin. He's the hero who turned water into wine, saving the day. He's the hero who resisted Satan's temptations so that you can resist Satan's temptations. He's the hero who raised Lazarus and gave him back to his family. He's the hero who healed the sick and cured the infirm, who preached the gospel to the poor, who persevered through the agony of Gethsemane because he wanted to please his Father and fulfill his mission and bring salvation to you and me. He's the hero who rose again, conquering sin, Satan, and death. He's the hero who has ascended to heaven to prepare a place for us. He is the hero who intercedes for us tonight before the Father. He is the hero who is worthy to break the scroll in Revelation chapter 5. He is the hero who breaks the seal in Revelation chapter 6. He is the hero who will hear the cry of the Jewish remnant and return from heaven to deliver and save all Israel at Basra. He is the hero who rides a white steed of victory to Jerusalem, who touches the Mount of Olives, and who slaughters mercilessly his enemies at Armageddon. He is the hero who will lead us from heaven on white horses, and he is the hero who will rule in the millennial kingdom, and that the government will rest upon his shoulders. He is the hero who is returning soon to rescue his bride from the wrath to come. Now, no human achievement, no mortal act, no courageous deed could ever match what Jesus Christ is about to do for us. And that's why we're here tonight. We celebrate who he is. And we talk about the pre-trib rapture, don't we? You know, this. I believe the pre-trib rapture is the most attacked and mocked doctrine in the church today. In fact, I can confidently say that the vast majority, in fact, maybe all of the hate mail I get is about the pre-trib rapture. Email, snail mail, I get posters people have made. Go figure. I was speaking at a church in Chattanooga, and I was talking about objections to the pre-trib rapture. About 500 people there, and a man stood up, a visitor in the church, stood up and began shouting at me, calling me a false prophet, telling me the whole pre-trib rapture thing is a demonic doctrine, that it's not true, that you're misleading the bride of Christ. I kept looking at his hands. I'm thinking, what's he going to pull out of his pockets here just a minute, and where is security? Some people say, you know, you guys believe in this pre-trib rapture. It's just simply a convenient escape clause for you from the tribulation. And I go, Yeah. What's your point? Of course it is. Of course it is. But it's more than that. It's the climax of a 2,000-year-old relationship. It's the realization of a longing treasured in the heart of a beloved betrothed bride. Love what Martin Luther said. He said, there are only 2 days on my calendar, this day and that day. This day and that day. It's the red letter date for all true believers, because those four words, I will come again, are the heart cry of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. I will come again. Now, I've looked in my Bible and I've tried as best as I can to study the New Testament, and I have been unable to come up with one single verse in the New Testament that speaks of imminency, that speaks of the fact, oh, wait a minute, maybe there's a couple of them here. All right, there's a few there. This longing that the bride has. The early church had that longing, beloved. They were eagerly anticipating, looking forward to. They couldn't wait. Brother, that's why they said Maranatha. Our Lord, come. We believe that's how they greeted one another. Not, how about them hogs? How about them razorbacks? That didn't work anymore. But Maranatha. And when they left church, they would say, Maranatha, may the Lord come before we meet again. I have three sons. My oldest was a West Point grad and served the Army faithfully. All of my sons love Jesus, but he has this longing for heaven like nothing I've ever seen. And we were talking about this very thing the other day. We had coffee together, and we both walked into our cars, and Clayton looked at me and said, hey, Dad. I said, yes, son. He said, Maranatha. I said, Maranatha, son. I think we need to bring back Maranatha to the church, reintroduce that incredible word. Imagine what it does for the heart of our Savior to know his bride is eagerly anticipating his soon return. Can you imagine you're about to get married, and you call up your fiance and you say, it's tomorrow. And she says, yeah. I'm sorry, we lost connection here. Would you repeat that one more time? You know, I probably did about 80 different weddings over the course of my career. I always did premarital counseling with the couple. And the last time, we always talked about the ceremony. And I would just say to the guy, and that last time, I said, look, this is all you need to do. You show up tomorrow with a suit and a pulse, and I'll get you through this thing. But the girl, I didn't say anything to her. You know why? Because she's been waiting for this day her whole life. She's been waiting for that day when her knight in shining armor would come riding in and sweep her off her feet. She spent the last year or so burning her dad's credit card up all over town, buying a wedding dress, talking to caterers and florists and wedding planners and people that aren't necessary in weddings and that kind of thing. Oh, she's ready. She's ready. We need to be ready for that hope, that blessed hope, because I believe it's that hope that carries us through the darkest times and the worst storms that we face today. That's why everything we do right now for Christ matters. Everything. That's why Paul wrote after talking about the rapture in 1 Corinthians 15, therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing, there's the confidence, that your toil is not in vain in the Lord. So for now, we labor in faith, we anticipate by faith, we work and we walk in this world in the confident hope of the promised one who will come. And we get out of that boat, we walk towards Jesus. Among the most epic historical and inspirational stories I've ever heard is the story of Sir Ernest Shackleton. In 1914, Sir Ernest Shackleton put an advert in a London newspaper, and it read this. It said, men wanted for hazardous journey, long hours, bitter cold, months without light, safe return, doubtful, reward in case of success. Shackleton was about to cross the Antarctic. The response to Shackleton's call was overwhelming. He thought maybe he'd get a dozen men. Over 500 men applied, each one hoping they would have the chance to accompany the knighted explorer, joining him on what they hoped will become the first ever crossing of the Antarctic continent on foot, a chance to write themselves into the history books. So after personally interviewing the applicants, Sir Ernest settled on 28 men, each of them a specialist in his own area of expertise. There were doctors and cooks and carpenters, seasoned seamen, all filled with anticipation upon accompanying Shackleton on the great voyage. Sailing to Antarctica in their boat called the Endurance, it soon began to be stuck in the ice, and the heavy megaton ice floes began to close in, crushing the ship's hull, and eventually it sank. So there they were at the bottom of the world with no hope. So they began camping on the ice floes for months. But soon the ice floes began flowing in unfriendly directions, and so Shackleton made the decision, we've got to get in our boats. We've got to row for nearby Elephant Island. Elephant Island was just a rock out in the Antarctic. It's about 100 miles from their position. And so Shackleton gave the order, and they began rowing for Elephant Island. Launching their three tiny lifeboats on April 19th, 1916, they rowed 100 miles north. And after a perilous journey, they finally reached their goal. But they then realized, we're not only 100 miles from where we used to be, now we are 800 miles from the nearest civilization, the nearest whaling village. So knowing there was no option left, Shackleton put together a re-rigged lifeboat, got four of his crew, including Captain Worsley, and he said, we've got to go get help. And so before he left, he gathered his men on the beach there, and he looked each of them in the eye, and he said, I'm going to come back for you. The boss is going to come back for you. And so he launched his lifeboats, and they sailed for South Georgia Island. The remaining 22 men waved goodbye to their beloved captain, perhaps for the last time. Should Shackleton fail in his mission to reach South Georgia, nobody knew they were there. Nobody cared because World War I had just started. They didn't know where to look for him. So the men began to camp under the lifeboats, just trying to survive on anything they could catch for food. Miraculously, after only 16 days of sailing in wild and furious weather, Shackleton sighted land, 800 miles in 16 days. Arriving on South Georgia Island after a terrible storm, Shackleton was dismayed to discover he had landed on the wrong side of the island. And now he would have to trek in waist-deep snow across the entire island to get to the whaling village. By the time the men got there, they looked so horrific that people ran from them because they were so scared. Shackleton began to put together a rescue operation. And five different times over the next 5 months, he was unable to get out of the harbor. Finally, getting a Chilean vessel when the ice floes parted, he was able to get out of the harbor and sail back to Elephant Island. But would any of his men be there? Would they be alive? Would they be sane? What would be their condition? Upon sighting the beach, there he saw his men there, ready and waiting. Captain Worsley grabbed his binoculars and looked through them and began to do a head count. He said to Shackleton, he said, they're all there, Skipper. They're all going home. The men climbed into the rigged lifeboats that went out to the mothership. And as soon as they got on board, Shackleton began to contemplate their narrow escape. And he said to them, he said, it is fortunate that you are all packed and ready to go. One of the men responded. He said, we never gave up hope. Whenever the sea was clear of ice, we rolled up our sleeping bags and we reminded one another, the boss may come today. The boss may come today. Jesus wants us to be ready. You know why? Because the boss may come today. Let's get our sleeping bags rolled up. Let's get out of that boat. Let's do courageous, fearless things with the time that we have left. Would you pray? Jesus, thank you. You truly are the hero for the ages. And we've experienced your heroic efforts in suffering the eternal wrath of God on our behalf on the cross, from conquering death victoriously for our benefit, so that we too will walk in newness of life and have a new life one day. Lord, we're waiting for the next prophecy to be fulfilled, that prophecy of that harpazo, that rapture, that blessed hope, that parousia, that appearance, that arrival. We can't wait to see you appear on shore in the sky. We can't wait for that trumpet to be blown, for the voice of the archangel. We can't wait to be caught up, to meet loved ones who have gone before us, but Lord, more than that, to meet you. Lord, until that time, may we not be afraid of the storm. May we walk into the night with the light of Jesus Christ, that even a group this size, the impact that can be made if we all get out of the boat and get about our Father's business. Lord, may you bless your word to our hearts tonight. In Christ's name we pray.
Of a mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpet as Gabriel sounds the call. At the midnight cry we'll be going home. I look around me and I see prophecies fulfilled and the signs of the times, they're appearing everywhere. I can almost see the Father as he says, "Son, go get my children." Yeah. And at the midnight cry, the bride of Christ will rise. When Jesus steps out on a cloud to call God's children, the dead in Christ shall rise to meet him in the air. And then those that remain shall be quickly changed, will be changed in a moment. And at the midnight cry, we'll be going home. I look around me and I see prophecies fulfilled every day and the signs of the times, they're appearing everywhere. I can almost see my Father as he says, "Son, go get my children." And at the midnight cry, the steps out on a cloud to call God's cheer. shall rise to meet him in the air, and then those that remain shall be quickly changed, will be changed in a moment, and at the midnight cry. Oh, at the midnight cry. At the midnight cry.